Hey everyone, welcome to another Cal 1 video, quite a revolutionary topic on the agenda, but before spelling out precisely what that is, let's first build up to it by starting in familiar territory. Suppose I want to find the derivative of this guy, 2x plus 1 to the second power. So far we have two options. We can break it up into a product of two things and employ the product rule. First times the derivative of the second, plus second times the derivative of the first. And that's what you see here, 2 times 2x plus 1, plus itself. All in all, it comes out to be 8x plus 4. Or, we could have distributed everything right on out, FOIL everything out, and employ the power rule. And that leaves us with exactly the same thing. 8x plus 4. Well, what if I were to up the ante? What if I change that 2 as an exponent to a 3? 2x plus 1 to the third power. Again, I still have just those two options. First, I need to rewrite it as a product of two things, so that's 2x plus 1 times 2x plus 1 squared, but I can't leave that squared on that second term. I need to FOIL that second term out. Thankfully, we did that above. And now we can employ product rule. Admittedly, a bit more tedious than the last problem because of that 3, but not terribly bad. There is my product rule. And of course, I also have the option of doing what I did before, distributing everything out, FOILing once, and then FOILing twice. So there we are, combining like terms to simplify, and we have another prime opportunity to use the power rule. The derivative of y with respect to x is 24x squared plus 24x plus 6. But what if I were to change that exponent of 3 to a 100? Do you want to FOIL this thing 99 to 100 times? Well, unless you're a masochist, of course you don't. With product or power rule, this problem is quite a frowny face. Ain't nobody got time for that, so hopefully there exists a better technique for finding the derivative, and indeed there does. It is called the chain rule. Now, here's a statement of the rule for now. A proof will be provided in a separate video. So, let us have f and g be differentiable functions. Differentiable boys, then we have that the derivative of f composed with g, the derivative of that entire composite function, is f prime evaluated at g times the derivative of g itself. There is the standard form of the chain rule. But sometimes it's not the most convenient form, so using alternative notation, letting y equal the composite function itself, and a simple u standing for g of x, so u is the thing inside the f, then we can rewrite the chain rule, boxed in green above us, so dy over dx is dy over du times du over dx. This form is often called the Leibnizian form of the chain rule. Conceptually, they mean the same thing, but visually, of course, they look quite different. The guy above in green, we can call him the composite notation. But Leibnizian notation in lieu of a proof has some intuitive pull, because you can think of those du's there and there as offsetting each other, canceling out, so to speak. So there's some intuitive pull there. I gotta caution you though, it's not strictly speaking a cancellation that occurs, because derivatives are functions. The properties of functions aren't as simple as the properties of simple fractions. So to really prove the chain rule, we need an actual better proof. This is not a proof, but I'm going to do it for now in light of its intuitive pull. So Leibnizian form has some intuitive pull to it, so let's deal with him. In solving the seemingly intractable 2x plus 1 to the 100th power problem down on the left. So I am raising some variable quantity to the 100th power. Let u stand for that entire variable quantity, 2x plus 1. Then, with that choice of u, then y is u to the 100th. And now look, if u is 2x plus 1, then du over dx, the derivative of u with respect to x, is 2. Likewise, the derivative of y with respect to the independent variable u, simple power rule, 100, u to the 99th. And now we are in prime position, ladies and gents, to deploy the chain rule. We have both of our pieces, both of our fractions, so to speak, dy over du, there he is, du over dx, there he is. Smush them together, and you are pretty much done. I say pretty much because the very final thing we have to do, if we're trying to find the derivative of y with respect to x, we want it to be a function of x. So substitute u back in as a function of x, and you are done. There we are. A tad simplification, 200 times 2x plus 1 to the 99th, and much, much quicker, much happier process. No need to foil out 99 to 100 times. This problem is a smiley face. It's a happy time with the chain rule, but quite a painful time without it. However, let's try the same problem using a slightly different approach, very slight. So recall that if I want to take the derivative of x to the 100th with respect to x, well, that's simple. I just bring the 100 down and subtract 1 from the exponent. But now look, x is just a variable. But who decided that variables need to be represented with letters? Variables can be represented with virtually anything. It can be a shape, like a smiley face, or a pink box, which is what I'll do here. So the derivative of pink box to the 100th with respect to pink box is 100 times pink box to the 99th. Again, variables don't need to be represented by letters. They can be represented by virtually anything. But the nice thing about this box is, why don't we just fill in that box with any variable quantity we want, like 2x plus 1. So the derivative of 2x plus 1 to the 100th power with respect to 2x plus 1 is simply 100 times 2x plus 1 all to the 99th. By the way, that guy on the left, he is notationally the exact same thing as this guy. Just pretty much, this is just the same thing, except we write it in a fractional guise, so to speak. So the derivative of that, 2x plus 1 to the 100th, with respect to 2x plus 1. Now, why in the world did I bother to do that? Well, let's go back to this problem here. 2x plus 1 is my pink box. I filled it in. So the derivative of y with respect to x, I can write that as the derivative of y. In this case, y is 2x plus 1 to the 100th. With respect to 2x plus 1, after I employ the chain rule here, all times the derivative of 2x plus 1 with respect to x. We just found that first derivative, underlined there in green. He is 100 times 2x plus 1 to the 99th, which is what we did on the left side of the screen. And now, of course, that second derivative of 2x plus 1 with respect to just a plain x is a simple 2. So a slightly different way to do the chain rule, and another different way to notate this. You can think of this as the Leibnizian form of the chain rule, color version, derivative of y with respect to x is the derivative of y with respect to pink times the derivative of pink with respect to x. Leibnizian form, color version, no u's in sight, instead just the color pink. So, Leibnizian form of the chain rule. This problem we just did, it was practically necessary to do the chain rule, but not impossible without the chain rule. Theoretically, you know, we could have foiled 99 to 100 times. Theoretically, we didn't need to use the chain rule. It just would have been very annoying to foil that many times. However, for these problems, the chain rule isn't just a practical necessity. It's a theoretical necessity. Without the chain rule, we would not be able to find the derivatives of these two functions. So let's start with number one here. Go about it the same way. My main operation is that I am squaring some variable stuff, so a good choice for a U, a pink box, is that variable stuff that I'm squaring. Squaring is my first operation, so to speak. So with those choices in tow, y is u squared, u is cotangent of x, so derivative of y with respect to u, 2u. And likewise, we see the derivative of u with respect to x being negative cosecant squared of x. And with this, we're pretty much done. Employ the chain rule, multiply those two things, dy over du times du over dx, underline there in pink, and we get this. But patterning off the problem before, we don't want just the thing in terms of u, we need it to be in terms of x. So u needs to be substituted as a function of x, and voila, we are done. There is our derivative via the chain rule. But now in practice, we don't like having to choose u's all the time. That quickly gets a little old. It can get tedious. So here's the chain rule alternative without the u's. Let's just do it in terms of color. Y is pink box squared. From henceforth, I'll just say pink squared. Y is pink squared. So the derivative of y with respect to x is the same thing as derivative of y with respect to pink times the derivative of pink with respect to x. Again, this is the color version of the Leibnizian form of the chain rule. The derivative of pink with respect to x, of course, that's negative cosecant squared of x. And now I just do power rule with the pink box. Bring the two down, subtract one from the exponent. There he is. Final step, just throw in what you chose your pink box to be. It's really conceptually the exact same thing as what we did down below, but just less verbally cluttered. It's more colorful. Likewise, let orange box be the tangent of the thing we're taking, so 4x squared. So y equals tangent of orange, so the derivative of y with respect to x is the derivative of y with respect to orange times the derivative of orange with respect to x. Let's find those two pieces. Well, tangent of orange, the derivative of tangent of orange is going to be secant squared of orange. And the derivative of orange with respect to plain old x is 8x. So again, number two, our main operation was taking a tangent of some variable quantity, and our variable quantity is what we boxed in orange. Now then, let's kick things up a notch. This right here is a menacing, but quite beautiful, chain boy. And I hope I can convince you of that as the problem goes along. Just a pattern parallel what we've been doing so far, let's just set that inside equal to y. And let's rewrite it, you know? I'm squaring cotangent of something, that's my first operation. And secant cubed, you can write that as secant of 3x, the whole thing cubed. So my first operation is raising something to the second power and then multiplying by 5. That's something I've boxed in blue. So same thing, colorful Leibnizian chain rule, there he is. The derivative of y with respect to blue times the derivative of blue with respect to blue. But now look, inside the blue, I'm taking cotangent of some variable quantity. Some further variable quantity, but that further variable quantity is not a simple x, it's a more complicated function of x. So I need to employ the chain rule again. Color form of the chain rule again, derivative of blue with respect to x is derivative of blue with respect to yellow times derivative of yellow with respect to x. But now once again, what's inside the yellow? I'm cubing something inside the yellow, but that thing I'm cubing inside the yellow is not a simple x, it's a function of x, namely secant of x, which I've boxed there in green. So further chain rule is needed. The derivative of orange, the derivative of yellow with respect to x is the derivative of yellow with respect to green times the derivative of green with respect to x. But again, what's in the green? I'm taking secant of some variable quantity, but that variable quantity is not a simple x. Again, ladies and gents, it is a function, complicated, more complicated function of x. 3x, boxed in pink. So I'm pulling the chain rule again. There we go. And now, we make the appropriate substitutions. Start from the bottom and work our way to the top. That guy goes there. That guy goes there. That guy goes there. And we can condense this information into one nice string. Derivative of y with respect to x is d dy over d blue times d blue over d yellow times d yellow over d green times d green over d pink and times d pink over d. So you can imagine those pairs of similar colors cancel each other out. But Anne, look at this. Look at this pretty chain. I'll have more to say about this in the future, but for now, that's, I have to mention that. So, if we can find those five derivatives, multiply them together, we're pretty much done. So y, remember, is the same thing as 5 times blue squared. Blue is the same thing as cotangent of yellow. Yellow is the same thing as green cubed. Green is the same thing as secant of pink, and pink is simply 3x. This implies some nice things about the derivatives. The derivative of y with respect to blue is 10 times blue. Simple power rule. The derivative of blue with respect to yellow, what's the derivative of cotangent? Negative cosecant squared of yellow. And the derivative of yellow with respect to green, nice little power rule, 3 green squared. And similar thing for the derivative of green with respect to pink, secant tangent of pink. And finally, this last guy, easy money, derivative of pink with respect to x. Pink is 3x, so 3. With those things, we toss it into our pretty chain. And we're done. We just have to make the appropriate substitutions for pink, yellow, green, and blue. So, first derivative is going to be 10 times cotangent of secant 3x. Cubed. The second derivative is going to be negative cosecant squared of that stuff. The third derivative is going to be 3 green squared. Green is secant of 3x. Then secant of pink times tangent of pink. Pink was 3x. And finally, 3. So, again, we were using those boxes on the left side of the screen to make the appropriate substitutions. And this problem in particular, I'll get to that in a minute, but notice, here are, once again, the derivatives with what they equal in the product string at the very top. And yeah, this is reminiscent to me of the movie Inception, which centered around dreams within dreams. However, this time the convo between Leo and Cillian goes a bit differently. Chain rule, quizzical look, derivative within derivative. It also brings to mind that old MTV show, Spruce Up My Ride, I think it was called. But instead of the host exhibit sprucing up people's rides, this time round he's sprucing up people's derivatives. Like, yo dog, I heard you like a chain rule, so I put a chain rule on top of your chain rule so you can chain rule by your chain rule. This is why when you see problems like this, the chain rule is often referred to as the spruce up my ride rule in the formal mathematical literature. It's an actual thing. So, when you see problems like this, think of spruce up my derivative. Finally, as nice as that colorful version of the Leibnizian chain rule is, eventually you want to try to wean yourself off of it. Because again, as nice as it is, it can get a bit tedious, so let's try to do all or most of these without falling back on the colorful Leibnizian chain rule. So this guy, I'm taking secant of some variable stuff. That variable stuff is not a simple x, it's a function of x, more complicated, 4x. So, the derivative of y with respect to orange is secant of 4x times tangent of 4x, and the derivative of orange with respect to x is just 4. And there we go. Likewise, for the second one, my main function is secant. I'm taking secant of some variable stuff. That stuff is more complicated than just a simple x. So derivative of y with respect to orange is secant of orange times tangent of orange times the derivative of orange with respect to x. And the derivative of orange, thankfully, is a simple 4x cubed. Things aren't so gravy with this third guy. But if we rewrite him as secant of that stuff to the 1/3 power, we can box all of that stuff. So we're taking secant of orange and patterning like before, the derivative of y with respect to x is the derivative of y with respect to orange. Secant of orange times tangent of orange. But I gotta multiply that by the derivative of orange with respect x, just like we did above. But notice, within the orange, I'm raising the variable quantity to the 1/3. But that variable quantity I'm raising to the 1/3 is not, again, a simple x. It's a more complicated thing of x. That implies that it's incumbent upon us to use the chain rule once again. Like so, but thankfully that guy in yellow is 4x cubed plus 4. And finally, we can string up our terms into a product string, like so. For this last one, though, I think I'm going to fall back on the colorful form of the chain rule just to make sure we have our bearings. If there's a lot of action going on, it might be a good idea, you know, to fall back on the Leibnizian, the colorful form. So notice I have boxed my functions in orange, yellow, peach, and green. So the derivative of y with respect to x, I can break up into a product of 5 derivatives, like so. Just like I did on the previous screen. And now the derivative of y with respect to orange is going to be secant of orange times tangent of orange. There we go. The derivative of orange with respect to yellow is going to be negative sine of yellow. Likewise, the derivative of yellow with respect to peach is going to be cosecant of e to the x squared. The derivative of peach with respect to green is e to the x squared. The derivative of e to something is just itself. And finally, the derivative of x squared with respect to x, derivative of green with respect to x is 2x. Now, one more complicated problem. Let's say you see a problem like this. For this, you don't want to employ the chain rule right off the bat. You want to frame this guy with the product rule, because we have some function of x times some other function with x, so we have to use the product rule. Don't start off with the chain rule just because something looks complicated. Be sure to step back, survey what's going on, and frame it with the appropriate derivative rule. So that derivative on the left, right there, is 2x. But this first derivative, that requires a chain rule, which thankfully we've done above. So making the appropriate substitutions gives us this. So, this was an example of a chain rule within a product rule. Who would have thought something so exotic was even possible? Even Exhibit, the host of Spruce Up My Ride, is flabbergasted. He's so excited. He can't believe it. This may seem like just another calculus problem to you and me, but to Exhibit, it's a whole new world.